Hello. Thank you for coming. That was Logan introducing me. If you haven't already seen her on line, I've posted some stuff that I duct taped her to a door during someone else's talk in one of the other rooms, and then I opened the door and she was duct taped to the door. So she's awesome. I've just got her started early for her S&M career when she's in her, when she's 20. What? 50 Shades of John. There's more like 120 Shades of John. Why do I always play with long flexible things? You can shut all you want. You better get ready, because it's me. Is everybody in? Said the actress to the bishop. Or said the choir boy to the priest. Anyway. Like it never happened. I can't see everybody. Can we just turn those lights down a little bit? Is that all right? Look at you with your finger on the button. Handsome, too. So I don't know how it's working here. Are you guys allowed to ask questions and things, or? You are? Are you? Do they have a microphone, or do I just have to hear you shout it? I just come to you. Oh yeah, that'll never happen. It's never gonna happen. Especially because you got boobies. I'm guessing. You never know nowadays, right? What? I'm whatever. Okay, that's fine. I like that. It's great to be in Vegas. What's that? Is that a microphone, Kevin? John. Kevin, are you going to be my mic man?
I can be your mic man, John.
Oh, Kevin. This is Kevon, everybody. Kevon. Just make sure you call him Kevon. Las Vegas. Here we are. Yes. It's not that far. Well, it's a 4-hour drive. 3-hour? What was it, Scott? We did it in 4 hours. We left Palm Springs and there was the fire in the San Bernardino Mountains, so it was becoming very cloudy and dark over Palm Springs, and we thought we're heading to Vegas, it'll be much better, but we had to drive up through the mountain. We didn't go the freeway, which was good, because East EDC. Oh. We drove by one car, it was two girls in it, they were wearing multicolored stuff, and there was a huge big penis inside the car. Scott and I were like, yeah! It was awesome. But we'd missed the traffic through the Cajon Pass, which is not a testicle roadway. Cajones Pass, get it? I knew you would, sweetheart. So we're driving and we come into the up the freeway a bit, and then there's massive traffic, and Scott says, on the sat nav, there's a road that goes off and parallels the freeway. So he said, well, let's just take that. So we did, and we paralleled the freeway for about 10, 15 miles, and then it said road closed. Not for me, it wasn't. We drove off road, went around the signs, and another guy in another SUV was following us, and we drove another 10 miles on the road that was closed, okay? Which was fine. Then there was another big sign that said, road closed, bridge out. So I took a little veer to the left, which then said, military base, do not enter. I've been in a lot of military. So to speak, Captain Jack. So we pulled off, but the guy behind us kept going straight, and he went down the other way to avoid the... We did off-roading on roads that said were closed, where no one was doing any work, so we could have used them, right? If you have an SUV, just drive down past the bridge. We made it, we beat all the traffic by about, 30 minutes? Yeah, look, I'm asking him for... I wasn't even paying attention. I was driving him like that. This is awesome! But we did. It was awesome. It was great to go off-roading. I'll shut up now and you can ask questions. Just thought I'd let you a little insight in my life, not that you're bored or anything. Kevin,
yes.
Where are you?
Right here.
Oh, on your knees like normal.
You wish.
Not for me, for Kelsey. Yeah, there you go. Because Logan, he's always praying. Logan's his daughter, I have to be careful. She knows me well. You choose. Put your hands up if you have any questions. I just like to play off you guys and feed off you, so to speak. Especially you two over there. Thanks for the butt rub, by the way. Photo op, all of a sudden the hands were on my back and then I felt them go down. I said, just go ahead, touch it. And then it went, ooh. I'm like, oh my God. What are your names again? Josh and Eric. It was Josh. Josh gave me the rub on the left and then Eric and I went, go on. He went, oh, okay. So whatever. I got a double whammy. It was good. Scott, get the numbers. We'll talk to them later, okay? Kevon, where are you? Okay, question.
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Patrick.
Hi, Patrick.
My question is, what was your favorite episode of Doctor Who to film, and why?
I'm very weird about answering favorite questions, because if I say what's a favorite, you guys never let me change my mind ever again. Right? And he said that at the Las Vegas con, and I can't, you know, it's not right. He's a hypocrite if he says he likes something else. I loved filming pretty much all of Doctor Who because it was a childhood dream of mine. I never ever thought that as a kid I'd ever one day be a companion or let alone one of the most iconic Doctor Who characters in the history of Doctor Who. So that's why I love every second of it. But I think most of the ones that I love, gosh, I love doing the episodes like anything with the Daleks, with Davros. Because Davros was my kind of ultimate fear as a child. I wish I'd been able to do a Cybermen, episode, because I love the Cybermen. I actually tried to convince Russell to let me be inside one of the cyber suits, just because I wanted to do it. And he's like, but we'd have to pay. I'm like, you don't have to pay me nothing. You ask anyone to be a Cyberman, they're going to be a Cyberman for you. So I would say the End of Days. I think it was that which one was the Dav? Was Davros End of Days? And it was when I was with Sarah Jane Smith, Elizabeth Sladen, and we were standing together, and Davros came out, and she grabbed my hand, and she went, oh, and I went, I know, and she goes, he still scares me to this day. And this is while we're filming. We're having this conversation while David's doing his lines, you know, and talking, and the camera's on him, we're in the background, and still can be seen, if you watch it, you can see us looking at each other, having a little chit-chat. But yeah, it was great. And also the fact that I was with the most iconic companion, Sarah Jane Smith, and that any companion who says they've never based any of their companion's personality on her or has a little bit of Sarah Jane in them, they're telling you a big old lie. Because she was the ultimate, and I was thrilled to be, you know, the first time I met her, she was, I was going to, we live in a building, and I still have the flat there because I bought it. That's how much of a geek I am. But all of us, we lived in this building, we called it Who Towers in Cardiff, and I would come in from shooting night shift, like if I was doing Torchwood, and David would be doing day shift, and we would pass in the elevators, and when I stepped into the elevator, and he's like, he's a night, John, I'm like, morning, David. And I go in, and I stand in the elevator, and I hear, hold the lift, and Elizabeth Sladen comes running in, and she stands, literally, and this is one side of the lift, the door's there, she runs, and she stands there, and I'm like that. In my head, I'm going, I'm Sarah Jane Smith. I'd never met her before, and I'm standing literally 2 feet away from her, and she's got her little hat on, and she's standing, and then she does one of these. And I said, I know how you feel. I mustered up the energy because I thought something like toilet paper windpipes is gonna come out of my mouth. But I got the energy up and I said, Miss Sladen, John Barrowman, I play Cap. She said, I know exactly who you are, Captain Jack. And she said, I like you. Sarah Jane likes you. But she would have to spank you if you continue to use that gun. Doors open, she walked out and I went and wet myself. With excitement. It was awesome. So yeah, So those are, that was more than the question, but that's kind of my, I tend to do that, go off on a tangent. Yes.
Hi there, handsome.
Hello.
Sorry, now you know how I feel. I'm like, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, it's fine, just blah, blah, just don't pee yourself.
It's too late.
It's too late? Save it, someone in Las Vegas will pay for it. Come on, you can't be that conservative here.
Don't be so suburban.
Yeah! Because it all happens in suburbia, let me tell you.
No kidding.
Yes.
I know you're a huge...
Logan, you will not remember any of this. This will all be retconned out of you.
I know you're a huge theater person. So, I mean, is it...
Is that another way to say I'm gay?
No. No, sweetie, because I'm a huge theater person.
Oh, so you're a lesbian.
No, I'm a gay man trapped in this woman's body.
Awesome, even better.
So, what was it like? I mean, does sci-fi just kind of lend itself? Is it just kind of flow easy for you back and forth, having that background?
It's what, theater, say it again.
Okay. Coming
from... I all of a sudden thought I was in a Tampax commercial, but never mind.
Coming from a more theatrical background.
Yes.
I mean, does that make sci-fi a little more easy to just translate into? Because there's so much more freedom.
Well, but it, yeah, yes and no, but sci-fi is probably harder than a lot of other mediums because if you're to do something with a big green screen behind you that is meant to be a planet being overtaken by 30,000 Daleks that are flying from the mothership and all you've seen is a drawing of it, but that's going on behind you and you have to react to that or you have to... do what you're doing here with one person and you're in a room that has nothing in it and you're on a spaceship in the middle of space, that takes a lot of imagination and a lot of energy to do because you could walk out and you could do one of these, which would be totally, you know, that would be really wrong. But I don't know if it makes it easier being in theater because in theater it's a very, you see the whole picture. It's going to sound really bizarre. When you're watching a theatrical play, you're watching everything, right? When you're on television, you're watching specifics. The camera will tell you what to see. So if I say, you know, there is something under the table, the camera goes right to the table. Whereas if I'm on a stage show and I say, there's something under the table, you're gonna look at the table quickly. Do you get what I'm saying? It's a completely different experience, but it possibly helps us with the kind of what I call the larger-than-life things that we have to get across to the audience. So maybe in a long way around that, yes. I had to think about it myself. No one's ever asked that question before. That's good. Yes.
Hi. I have so many women requested I ask this of you.
Oh, dear.
Back when you were in John McIntosh's tree... Cameron McIntosh.
Remember, my mother and father are here.
Yes.
Yes, no.
Just answer one thing.
No, they've read the book, by the way. They don't care. Yes.
When you were swinging, were you sitting on a swing that hangs off the tree? Were you sitting on a tree branch?
People don't know what you're talking about. So I'm going to let you explain to them, since you brought it up, what you're talking about. All I'll say, Cameron McIntosh, the theatrical producer who produced Miss Saigon, Cats, Phantom, I know him very, very well. I'm not going to explain it. You get back on your feet, cane or no cane, girl, you stand up. I treat everybody the same. So an incident happened in his tree in the south of France at his house. What was the incident?
You and Scott had sex in swinging in a tree.
Yes.
And we just can't imagine how you would do that in a tree.
Oh, I bet you've imagined lots of times.
Oh, lots, honey, lots.
Don't give me that lie. I can tell by the big smile and rosy cheeks on your face. You've imagined a whole lot of times.
All right, thank you.
No. What do you say thank you for?
Okay, look.
No, you want to know if we were in a swing?
Were you on like a tree hanging swing?
We were not on a swing.
So were you leaning against the tree or sitting on a branch?
We were in the goddamn tree.
You were on a big branch.
We climbed up the tree and one of us was hanging and the other one was swinging.
That's it, I was right.
Someone was standing still, someone was swinging. You get the picture?
Oh.
Welcome to Gay Sex Diary. But you know what? I'm sure loads of other people have done it that way too, right? Good for you. See? My naughty women. You'll be thinking about that again tonight, won't you? The Vegas Strip will be rocking. Oh, I love how like 20 people are going, I know what he's talking about. Others are going, because they don't want anyone to know they got one. Yes.
Speaking of Gay Sex Diaries, I saw you. This is gonna
How
go.
How old are you?
19.
Okay. This is gonna legal go, ages.
This is gonna go from
no,
zero to
18
60.
No, 18 is the age of consent, isn't it? Yeah. In Nevada, you can have sex with anybody.
Oh.
What is it? 16. Oh, you're fine.
Oh.
Last time I did that, I was somewhere else, and the person, you know, because kids look older these days, right? I sound so old now. Kids look older, and this girl asked me this question, and I said, I gave the answer, and I went, whoa, how old are you? And she went, 14. And her dad and mom went, it's okay, she knows everything. We're cool with it. I'm like, thank God. So okay. Yes, yeah. Are you going to work or something? No, I'm just kidding.
This is gonna go from zero to 60. So I was watching.
All right, just be careful of what you're gonna say, all right?
Okay, so.
Use innuendo.
I was going on a whole binge of one of my favorite directors, Mel Brooks, and I happened to notice someone in one of their movies, the producers, and I thought.
I am not singing it for you.
Not what I was gonna ask. I was gonna ask how, like, you, was it hard taking something really serious and turning it into something very flamboyant and completely making fun of it,
no,
but still like...
No, because I firmly believe, and I've said this, and that I just did a 23-city concert tour around the UK, and I tell jokes, I say things, I make fun of myself. I believe that we're becoming a society where we're not laughing at situations. You know, terrible things can happen. Once they've happened, there's a certain time, you know, it can be too soon, but eventually, you have to laugh. You have to find the humor in everything. It's like when Scott and I went to get married, and we were at a registrar's office in Riverside County, in Indio, and we went to the registrar's office, and there was, you know, loads of other couples that were there, but they were all aged between 75 and 85, right? And I said to Scott, we gotta get to the front of the line. Well, it wasn't hard because half of them were, you know, find the humor, right? It was funny, and we did. We got to the front of the line, got married, and then we helped the rest of them to get married. So, but that was, it was a movie that was written about a terrible thing that happened, but we can now look at it, and it's still an awful thing that happened, but you have to find a humorous side to it, and Mel Brooks is brilliant in that way, that he finds that humorous way, because they weren't just taking the mickey, or as we say in the UK, taking the piss out of what happened. They were taking the piss out of one individual in that sequence, in that stuff. And that person should have the piss totally taken out of them, if you know what I'm talking about. So that's, yeah. But we need to laugh at ourselves more. We need to poke a little fun at ourselves. I'm the first one to poke fun at myself. I'm the first one to poke myself, is that right? You what? Innuendo joke, good. Like that, yes.
Hi, okay.
Hi.
I'm cross-dressing as Castiel, by the way.
Okay.
Okay.
I'll keep my hands off you.
Sorry. Sorry, okay. Okay, I just...
How old are you?
I'm 18.
You're 18, well, just hold the mic up. Just hold it up. These people don't want to hear you laugh for an hour.
Sorry, okay, all right. So I just want to say that I'm bi, and I really want to thank you for your Captain Jack role and how you made it, portrayed it like that, because it was really nice to see a superhero that was, you know, bi. Sorry.
Well, he was omnisexual.
He was everything. But, you know,
yeah.
Close enough.
Good, and, well, I'm glad.
And to continue that note, which is kind of a different note. Anyway, sorry.
I suddenly feel like Oprah today.
Are you, sorry.
But a lot lighter.
Are you wearing your superhero underwear?
Don't ooh. She's a big girl.
Are you wearing your superhero underwear?
I'm not wearing superhero underwear, no. No, don't get me wrong, I love Oprah. I think she's great. But, yeah, I'm not wearing superhero underwear. I'm wearing plain, old, tidy whiteies. Because I'm just flopping about. Okay, next one.
Hello.
Kai.
Hello.
Kai, are we going to work over to the back, Kevin? Here we are. Yes, where are you?
I'm here.
You're here. Oh, hi.
I'm here. Okay, so what I would like to know is, do you still have Scott Bakula's signature on your ass?
No.
No.
It washed off a long time ago.
Well, I didn't know if he used permanent ink.
Yeah, he did use permanent ink, but my skin is so smooth. It just rubbed right off. And I went home and Scott went, who's Scott Bakula? Literally. I was getting in the shower and he went, who's Scott Bakula? I said, oh, just someone who's a fan. Y'all don't know, it's Scott. In the UK, I hosted, was there seven of them captains or five? Seven or five captains from Star Trek, and I love Star Trek. They asked me to host that that event, and I did. And all the captains, it was really interesting. You know, from everyone, from Scott Bakula to Captain Janeway and Bill Shatner, and all the others, all the ones that. And it was interesting to hear them all talk, and also for me as a fan, also to ask the questions that I knew that everybody else wanted to know. And I then, you know, admitted to Scott Bakula that I was a total fan of his from when he was in his Broadway days. And I asked him if I could have an autograph. And he said, well, do you have anything to sign? I went, no, but sign my butt cheek. And he went, okay. And he just signed it. And he was like, I can't believe I'm doing this. And I'm like, I can't believe you're doing it either. But just to the middle a little more and sign. And yes.
Hi, I'm Christine.
Hi.
So we're so used to seeing you as Captain Jack and a superhero and stuff, but lately you've been playing bad guys. You've been Merlin.
Lately I've been playing a misunderstood hero.
However you want to look at it. You have to admit you were pretty bad in Desperate Housewives, though. I mean,
you
blew up a house.
Yes, I was an eco-terrorist.
Yes. So how has the transition been from being so loved to being someone who's love-hated, who's someone misunderstood so much?
Well, you say that, but Captain Jack was love-hated, believe it or not, because the day that I murdered my grandson to save the planet, I was in the, you know, we did it, and I met Bear, he's a man now, the kid who played my grandson. He came to one of my concerts, and he came up to me afterwards, and he said, John, it's Bear, and I went, oh my God. I'm like, you're this big now, and he's like, yeah, and I'm studying, you know, acting and doing all sorts of stuff and having a great time. I'm like, how old are you now? And he's like, I'm 18. But when I was doing that sequence with him, I told him, he said, you know, what can I do, John, to make this a little better? And I said, well, when you look at me, when we're doing the sequence, don't take your eyes off of your grandfather, right? Don't take your eyes off of me. And I said, what I want you to do is I want you to start just lightly shaking. Then I want your whole body to start shaking and just keep looking at me. Don't take your eyes off me, Bear. And I said, I'm going to give you a little sponge with some blood in your mouth. And when you think it, when I give you a little wink, you just bite down on that sponge and the blood will just then pour out of your mouth. And he said, okay. And this is, at that time he's probably like, what, 9, 10 years old, right? And so he's standing there and we do the sequence and he starts shaking. And then he starts shaking a little more violently. And then I gave him the little wink and he bit down. And not only did he bite down, but the blood came out of his mouth and then some came out of his nose. He stuck a little sponge up there and did that and it squeezed. I'm like, you're a brilliant kid. And then he dropped to the ground and people afterwards, well, I went to the supermarket the next, like, you know, after the episode had aired. And the day after I was in the supermarket, I was in the frozen food section. Yes, I like my frozen food. Scott's like his fish fingers, don't you, Scott? Yes, we were in the frozen food section, and this woman walked, literally, I was there, she did one of these.
You can just press
it. I hate you for what you did. What, did I touch your fish? I don't know. She's like, I hate you for what you did to your grandson, but I still love you. Oh my God, it's John Barrowman. So he wasn't liked for that kind of stuff. But Malcolm Merlin, I think, you know, Merlin, I do. I think that he's, I don't play him as a bad guy. I play him as somebody who, this is going to sound, Thank you. Somebody who will do anything to get the job done, kind of like Captain Jack. If you're in the way and you're involved in doing something that's going to cause humanity to suffer, in my eyes, you're done. You're out. That would be Captain Jack. Malcolm Merlyn, you're standing in the way of my city. You're standing in the way of my daughter or Oliver Queen, who I love like a son. You're standing in the way of anything that I have to do to save my world. You're done. And that's how I look at it. And I play it that way so that I try to do something different each time, because when Malcolm is talking to you, if you get a smile from Malcolm, you're in trouble. Big trouble. And I try to do that because when people, online, they're like, oh my God, he totally smiled at him. It's gonna hit it now. It's all gonna happen. And I love that. But I do get it with Malcolm. I get, man, I love you, but I hate you. And I'm like, thank you. Job done. So I'm not, I don't feel bad when someone says that they hate me. Next one.
Back right.
Hello.
Hi. Did you have any issues getting...
Oh, I got a lot of issues. Just ask my family. Go ahead.
Did you have any problems getting into the acting business being openly gay?
No, because I was... I didn't really talk about it when I first started, because I grew up in a generation where you just didn't really talk about it. You just kind of did your thing, because if you did talk about it, it could have caused problems. But I will say that I was one of the first actors to openly talk about who I was and who I am and being a gay man. And I did that purposely because there was a situation where I was doing a TV show, and I came home to Scott, and we'd been seeing each other for how long at that time? It was less than 10 years. It was about eight years, I think. And I came home, and all our friends knew, people in the industry knew, in the UK, because I'd never hit it. But I was doing a show in America, and I was pulled into the producer's office, and they sat me down, and they told me, we don't want you to talk about Scott, we don't want you to say that you're gay, we don't want you to do this, and da-da-da, and they rattled through all of this stuff in so many words, in a polite way, and I kind of went, okay, and I got up and I left the office and I went back to Scott and I said, they want me to do this, 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 and this, and he said, well, what do you want to do? And I said, well, I can't live a lie. I can't be something that I'm not and then pretend to be, I can pretend on camera to be these characters, but as a real person, I can't pretend to be somebody else. That's just bull. That's rubbish. I said, and also, if I was somebody watching television and I knew that that person was lying about who they were, how would that make me feel as a person who's in that same position, that I have to lie? So I didn't. I changed right there and then. From that moment on, my life just went voomph, and I thought, if people don't want to hire me because of who I am at home, that's their problem, because I will always find work. I will always do something else. I will push myself, and my dad used to always say to all of myself and my brother and sister, be the best at what you do, and no one can deny you anything, no matter who you are or what you are, right? And that's what you should do. And I haven't been back in that closet since. Hi, sweetheart.
What show did you like better, Torchwood or Doctor Who?
Oh, I hate you for asking that question. But I love you and your gorgeous skirt and your boots. That's totally awesome. Which did I like best? I have to say that I probably liked them both equally. Is that okay? Because Doctor Who, I don't know if you were here earlier, when I was a little boy and I became part of the Doctor Who cast, I never thought that would happen. But what was awesome about Torchwood was that was my own show. And because the character of Captain Jack became so popular on Doctor Who, they decided to give Captain Jack his own TV series. And many of you might not know this, but they were going to do Torchwood first. Russell T. Davies went to the BBC and wanted to do Torchwood first, and he was going to call it Excalibur. And they said, no, do the revamp of Doctor Who, and then we will do Torchwood. And that's how it came up. Thank you, sweetheart. Thank you. I know ice cream is more important. You're welcome. Yes. Who's where? Hi. No, it's turned off. Yep. 1 minute. Battery's dead. Well, there you go. Here comes another one. Don't rush yourself. He's like that.
Thank you. Testing.
What? Oh, mine went out. You're very quiet. What? You're attentive. Oh, don't. You can be rude. I don't care. You're just mesmerized by my ass? Show everybody your mesmerized face. Go on, look at this. There you go. That's mesmerized. Yes.
All right, so when you were in Seattle this past March, I was at the evening with John Barrowman, and you made a comment about my TARDIS dress.
Yes.
I'm wearing a David Tennant dress at the moment. I was wondering if the same thing applies.
No, because I've been in the TARDIS, but not in David Tennant. And you thought I wouldn't remember. I'm like an elephant. I never forget. Aren't I like an elephant, Scott? We play zoo on a Friday night in our house.
Who's the better kisser, David Tennant or James Marsters?
Oh, that sucks. David's a good kisser. James is a good kisser. James was very, when we did that sequence, it was really funny because I told the camera crew to keep rolling, and the director to keep doing takes because I gotten to know James and, you know, talking to him off stage, and I thought I'm Spike from Buffy, so I'm gonna take every opportunity. And my sister's like, if you gotta kiss him, just keep kissing him. I'm like, okay. So we did the sequence, and I told the director to keep doing it until I said not to do it anymore. So we did the sequence, we, you know, across from each other, and we walked up, and we looked, and we went, cut! And we'd cut, and I'd walk away, and James actually would walk over to his girlfriend, and he'd start going, to her, to reaffirm his masculinity. And then they would say, doing it again. And now this, we did it, you know, again. Oh, I walked away like, and then he walked over to the girlfriend. Oh. By about the fifth time, you were saying, and action. I walk up and I go. Cut. And I go, whoo. And James is like, oh my God. His girlfriend, oh. What was hysterical is it was freaking him out. She was getting turned on by it all. Because she would say to me, she'd be like, she said, I so love it when you're kissing him. Just keep doing it. Well, and this poor James, like, oh my God. Finally, when we cut, and he's like, oh, it took so long. I'm like, yeah, sorry. I love my job. But he was a good kisser. He was a very good kisser. But I mean, what am I going to say? Who one's better? No. I've had them all. Who would you like to kiss? What? Spike. There's a reason they call him Spike. Oh, okay. Yes.
Hi. Other than Doctor Who, if you had to pick a show to be in that you admired as a child, what show would that be?
As a child? 6 Million Dollar Man. Or Buck Rogers in the 25th Century. Commander Wilma Deering. The only woman who never had camel toe in a latex outfit. Lycra outfit, right? Kevin is Aaron's son. Yeah. So, and Aaron runs the company Heroes for Hire, who I work with all the conventions. So Aaron is into this also, who played Commander Wilma Deering. And I met Gil Gerard through Aaron, and I literally was like, Buck Rogers, I love you. I have all the figures, but that and $6 Million Man are my two favorites that come right to the top of my head. First time I met Lindsay Wagner, I was at Comic-Con in San Diego. I'd just done a panel. I was coming out, came in, got into my car. Car started pulling away, and I saw Lindsay Wagner standing, waiting to go in. I said to the driver, "Stop!" Screeched. She looked over like, "Oh my God," and like a terrorist. I jumped out of the car and went, and then I belted towards her, and you could see her going, "Oh shit." She thought I was like, I was a mad fan. And I ran up to her and I went, "Oh, I love you. $6 million, you know, Bionic Woman, $6 million, hugged her. And then I went, "Oh my God, I'm John Barrowman. I'm so sorry. I just realized," she's looking at me going, sweat beads coming. And then I think it was your mom or someone coming up behind me going, "It's okay, Lindsay. He's one of us. He's just excitable." Jump to a year later, we're having a big dinner with all the Heroes for Hire people who all work together. And everybody's in the dining room, you know, the room in the private room that we had at the restaurant. And I walked in, Lindsay Wagner at the table, she did one of these. She went, I'm like, "Okay, I just brought the doll. Would you sign it this time, please?" Yes, where are we?
Hello, lovely.
Hi.
Welcome to Las Vegas.
Thank you.
And my question for you is, how does singing fulfill you creatively in a way that acting doesn't, and vice versa? How does acting fulfill you creatively in a way that singing doesn't?
They're kind of the same thing to me, because they're both performing, and dialogue that you say without music is without music. Songs that you sing are dialogue with music. And you have to be able to sell. A lot of singers just get up and sing, but when you can hear a singer actually interpret the words and make sense of those words as you hear an actor make, so they're very, very, very similar, very much alike. And it's one thing that I've tried to do with what I do is to try to make them very similar and very much alike, because I've always disliked when people say, "Oh, you're a singer, you're an actor." No, you're kind of one and the same thing. Or you're a musical theater actor and you're an actor. What does that make me, less of one? You know, because I've done musicals? I'm actually better, because I can sing, dance, and act all at the same time. All you can do is speak. Ian McKellen, Sir Ian McKellen, who I know quite well. Ian was, we were doing the musical Anything Goes in London's West End. And Ian was doing a thing where he was going, kind of like a bucket list, but it wasn't his bucket list. He was doing something where he wanted to do everything that he's always wanted to do, and he wanted to be in a musical. So we dressed him in one of the outfits, and we put him into the number Blow Gabriel Blow. And after we were done, we got off stage, and it was, you know, he'd had a little bit of rehearsal, and we showed him what to do, and he was singing and doing it. He knew the song, and he came off stage afterwards at the end of the act, and I'm like, "How was it? How was it?" He goes, "Wonderful." And it was amazing to see someone who was so involved in doing such dramatic stuff and what they call, you know, straight acting, although he's not straight. And everybody knows. You know, but it was amazing to see the thrill that he got from all of that. So I see them being as very, very much the same. Emotionally, I get different things out of different, you know, I get, singing to me is more me doing it rather than a character doing it, whereas dialogue is the other person doing it. I still feel it, and I still put myself in that situation, but for me, the singing is, you're getting an insight to a bit of my heart and soul when you hear me singing songs, or when you see me on a tour on stage, like in what I just did in the UK. You're getting part of John Barrowman, not part of Malcolm Merlyn or Captain Jack. That's the difference. Welcome. Yes.
Right here.
Hey, what's going on? Nice shirt.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
My name's Adrian.
Show everybody.
My name's Adrian, and I have one question.
Okay.
The other day, I learned you are a huge Barry Manilow fan.
Yes.
My question for you is, if you had the chance to either just put the song on your on an album...
I do a Barry song on every album.
I know. I just do a remake of the video he did for it. Would you do Read 'Em and Weep?
I don't know Read 'Em and Weep.
You don't know that?
No, the video. A video for it?
Yes. Google it. It's on YouTube.
YouTube it. I'm sure it is. I will look, because Barry I know quite well. I've actually sung with Barry. I sang with Barry in front of 40,000 people in Hyde Park. And Barry and I did a duet, and I was the first one. I Made It Through the Rain, which is one of Barry's big songs, and I took it into the charts, into the top 10 in the UK, which was an amazing thing for me. But I will look it up. I will. I don't know that song very well. How does it go? Can you sing it? No? Chicken. I'm not that good. You're not that good. I don't care if you're not good. People just have a voice. Sing.
Why don't you look at me and read 'em and weep?
Why don't I look at you and read 'em and weep? I don't even know if that's a tune. See? Okay, next. Yes, Stormtrooper.
You were you got your MBE?
Yes.
Was curious about that. You got to go before the Queen. Can you tell us about that?
I got my for those of you who don't know, an MBE is a member of the British Empire. It's an honor that's given to you from the Queen and honored by the country, the United Kingdom. It's a medal. It's kind of, there's not really an equivalent in the US, but if the president were to give you the president, what is the one they give you at the Kennedy Center? Dad, the what? Yeah, but there's nothing to do with military about it. Is it congressional to do with military? Freedom Medal. Okay, but this one you go and you get invited into, you're nominated. I was nominated by 10 Downing Street, by the government. And it was for my services to the entertainment industry and to charity. And I was asked to go to Buckingham Palace, and I took Scott and my mom and dad. And you go with all other people who are given these honors. You hear about, I don't know if you've ever heard of it, it's called the Queen's Honors. And, well, there I am. That was very funny, though. We got out of the car in the middle of the quadrangle in Buckingham Palace, and I had put my mom in one arm, my dad in the other, and Scott on one arm, and my brother, my dad, and we started. I said, "Look, we're all going to walk into the palace together because this is like a." I've been to Buckingham Palace before to do things for the Queen and for the royal family and other stuff, but this was a big moment for us as a family. And we're walking towards the palace steps, and my mom turns and she says, "See, when I pushed you out 48 years ago, I never thought that one day I'd be walking up the steps of Buckingham Palace with my very own queen."
Nice.
I let her have that one. I did take her Chanel handbag away for 2 hours as punishment. But you go up, and then you go into you're in the throne room, and they get seated with all the other family members that are there, and they call your name, and you walk up. And it was Princess Anne who was presenting the award to me, because I do all my charity work with her, quite a lot of it. And when I went up there, and you bow, or I was wearing my kilt, and I thought I bow, but I'm not going to curtsy. That would be really crass. So I just bowed, and and then she said, "Fancy seeing you here." I'm like, "Yeah, whatever." Had a great conversation with her. It's a great honor. It's something that I'm exceptionally proud of, and not many people can say they have them. And so I'm chuffed. Particularly, since I'm someone who's gone away and then come back to the UK. But brilliant. That's all I can say, really. I love it. Yes. Where are we? Hey.
Hey.
What's up?
I have one comment and two questions.
Okay.
First comment is on Arrow.
Yep.
You're one of the reasons why I keep watching the show, and forgive my language, but as Malcolm Merlyn, you play a good son of a bitch.
Good. That's not bad language.
And
that's just words.
And first question, in regards to Arrow, do you ever think that Malcolm Merlyn will be in an episode as part of the Suicide Squad?
Next question.
All right, and my next question is, if you were ever to go to Marvel, which hero or villain do you hope to be cast as?
Well, I love both, and my DC friends, you know, Jeff Johns and all the guys over at DC know that I am also a Marvel fan, but most of those superheroes have already been, the big ones have already been taken care of, and they're, you know, already, I'd have to really think about that. I'm really loving playing Malcolm Merlyn, and I can't talk about it, what's going to happen, or what, you know, we start filming in July, season 4, but all I can say, yeah. I just finalized my deal a couple of days, about a week ago, so. No, it's nobody. I was going to find, if they'd have said, we're paying you 10 cents, I would have said, okay. No, I'm kidding, I wouldn't, no. But it was nothing like that. It was just about working out dates and stuff. So I'm very excited about going back. I can't tell you anything because I do know a bit of what's going to happen. But if you love Malcolm Merlyn, if you love Oliver Queen, if you love Thea Queen, if you love, you know, the Canary Sisters. I say that with a bit of a, you know, a twist and a joke in it. You're going to love what's going to happen across the DC world. Hey, Mayo!
Hey, how you doing?
Good.
In regards to Torchwood, how would you describe the other members of the team when you were acting with them?
You mean the people themselves?
Yeah.
Loopy. Because I'm the biggest nutcase on set. Eve Miles and I are like a naughty brother and sister when we get together. Bern Gorman, who I love dearly, Bern, we would just, at work, we would laugh. And we would try to take the mickey out of each other while we'd be doing, I mean, half of the sequences I did with Eve on her close-up camera over my shoulder, my testicles were hanging out. Just to throw her off. And she would do the lines and she'd do the stuff. And then she'd go, he's got the kids out again, doesn't he? And I'm like, what, no, no, and no, none of the camera guys, they'd all be going, and she's like, they are, they're out. I said, look, she's like, I'm not looking up. Oh my God, I looked. So we would do all sorts of stuff like that. And you know, Gareth, who played Yanto, lovely. And you know, he was, out of all of them, he was the best kisser, let me tell you. But, you know, and Naoko was lovely, but Naoko couldn't walk in heels, and they always put her in these freaking high heel shoes, and we'd be like doing a sequence, and she'd go, oh, 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 every shot, again, just take the goddamn shoes off, Naoko. She's like, sorry. My nickname for her, like, Eve was Evie, okay? Bern was Binny Bot, okay? And then I was Ginny Baza. Gareth was Hard Boy. And Naoko was Ping Pong Buckaroo. She's very talented with ping pong balls. And she loves it. She's not really. It was, but I used to call her also Coco Chanel. So we had nicknames. We loved all working together. And they were a great bunch of people. And when we see each other, we go quite a bit nuts. Even I have a tendency to go nuts. Yes. Huh? Yeah, last question. Last question. But they didn't start till 4:15. Yeah, then that's cutting short an hour by 10 minutes. I, you know, if you cut something short of 10, you're left with one, and one ain't good. 10's better. Yes.
How about 1 10 times?
1 10 times. I love optimism.
I think I can. Anyway, with all your pals over at DC, there's a great comic book that they have out right now, and it's called Batman 66. It's the further adventures of
Batman.
Adam West's Batman and Robin in comic form.
Awesome.
Is there any chance, and I want executive producer credit, that we're going to get you as Bruce Wayne in the tights? Can I make this happen?
I've got my own tights at home, but they're not Batman's tights.
Would you be Bruce Wayne?
Well, Bruce Wayne is Bruce. Well, yeah, I mean, I don't, yeah, I would love to, of course I would. I don't know if that would ever happen, but it would be awesome. Totally awesome. You can work on it. But, you know, my sister and I are doing, I'm not going to say what, but my sister and I are in discussions with DC about doing a comic. That's all I'm going to say. Oh, yes. It's going to be awesome. Yes.
Hi. I don't know if you remember me from Gallifrey 1, but I had mentioned to you a while back that I had, like, very lack of confidence because of my writing, and you told me to be more confident. Just want to let you know I have been working on that.
Good.
And the other question I actually had for you is, do you have any stories about what happened to Gallifrey 1? Because I know that Eve and everybody else has hilarious stories with the Brotherhood.
I have to tell you, Gallifrey 1, I came in, I did it, and then I went home. What? My tour. Honey, if you were on my tour, I woke up, I ate, did a show, and went to bed. That was my routine, because I did 23 dates over the course of a month. And I was exhausted. So no fun. My commitment in my tour was to make sure that I had a voice for every show for people who were paying a lot of money to hear me sing for 2 hours straight, right, and tell stories. So I didn't do any outrageous stuff. The outrageous stuff more so happens on set because I have downtime and all I have to do is talk. But yeah, I did Gallifrey 1. I didn't get up to much because I went to Gallifrey 1 and then I went back to Palm Springs. And they all, you know, hung around. I couldn't on that occasion stay up all night. However, in Germany, in Dusseldorf, Germany, Eve and I were doing this exactly same thing and sitting talking to each other. And I leaned over to her and I said, Evie, do you want to go out tonight? And she's like, Jenny Baza, I'd love to. So we went out, we partied, we had a great time. We went up to my room at about 1 o'clock and we popped open a bottle of champagne and I had the champagne out and we're dancing and we love the Mumford & Sons and we put on Mumford & Sons and I said to her, right, Eve, we're gonna open up the windows and we opened up all the windows to the hotel and we're dancing and we took all of our clothes off. I said, we're dancing naked. And we started dancing naked and she starts doing all this with her boobies and I put my face in it and don't know why, it just seemed the right thing to do. And then I did all this stuff, and I was doing the helicopter because I can. And so we're dancing and dancing, and we decided we needed to get some sleep at 6 o'clock because we were getting up at 7 to do signings. And we were a little late for that, but we went down to get breakfast, and we're walking into the breakfast room, and everybody burst out into applause in the breakfast room. And she looked at me, and she went, Jenny? And I went, I don't know, they're German, just smile. Sing Springtime for Hitler, no. Actually, they requested that in Germany. I'm like, are you kidding me? Me on a stage in Dusseldorf, Germany, singing Springtime for fucking Hitler? Are you crazy? So we're sat, we come in, we're in the breakfast room, and this other American celebrity walks up, and he says, hey, John, Eve, great show last night. What do you mean, great show? And he said, great show, but next time you dance naked in your room with all the windows open, you might want to check that there's not a mirrored building across the street. And by the way, Barrowman, nice helicopter. So those are the kind of things that happen when we have time. Oh, she did. She did, yep. So you know it's true, girl. Yes, I told that one on my tour. And Eve's picture and everything up, and she's going, oh my God, yes.
Okay.
Hi.
Okay, I don't even know how to talk after that, but.
That's okay.
Okay, so I admire your acting, you're a wonderful actor. I actually want to get into the acting business and screenplay writing, and I hope to run into you in the entertainment business.
Good. Hire me if you become popular. She's going, ah. Yeah, she's like, never.
I hope.
Okay.
But I was just hoping if you could sing You're the Top with me.
Wow, you didn't know. Start, ready, go. Oh, you got the words. Good, you lucky bitch.
Well, I have your words, too.
No, I know them.
Okay, I was hoping.
Because I'm a professional.
Well,
whose part are you going to sing? Billy's or Reno's?
Billy,
you want to be the boy?
No,
fine,
no,
I'll be the girl.
Reno.
Reno. Okay.
Have words poetic. I'm so sorry.
Take a deep breath and take it down a couple of pitches because that's way too high for me.
For me.
Do you want me to start it?
Sorry, I'm like fangirling the way you were with Sarah.
That's okay. Like I said, just don't pee.
No promises.
I'm going to start it. Ready? You ready? At words poetic, I'm so pathetic that I always have found it best. It's words there. Instead of getting them off my chest,
I let them rest.
unexpressed. I hate parading my,
serenading as I'll probably miss a bar. But if this ditty is not so pretty, at least it'll tell you how great you are.
You're the top. You're the Coliseum.
You're the top, you're the Louvre Museum. You're a melody from a symphony by Strauss. You're a Bendel bonnet, a Shakespeare sonnet. You're
Mickey Mouse.
Everybody! Scott, come here, please, please. Yes.
Okay, so you have nicknames for your Torchwood co-stars.
Yes.
And Billy Piper has a nickname for David Tennant.
Uh-huh, David Tennant.
This is a two-parter. Can you confirm that? And what are your nicknames for your Doctor Who co-stars?
I've let's just say yes. We didn't really have nicknames because what you got to remember is that on the show, because Torchwood, I was the leader. It was my show. I was in control of everything. But when we went on, when I was on Doctor Who, it was David's show. So I let him do the kind of leading in that, and he had a lot to say and a lot to do. And Billy and I were the ones who usually had the jokes. But I can't tell you what my nickname was for Billy. No, I'm not gonna say it because it's private. But it has something to do with a pipe. Anyway, anyone have a question for Scott? No? Does he snore? Do I snore or does he snore? I do not snore.
We do. We have the bed. We have to press the button and go.
That wasn't the question. We have a bed that vibrates. Yes, we do. We bought one of those sleep number beds. Have you ever seen those? Oh my God, they're so comfortable, aren't they? Scott likes to sleep. If this is the bed, this is my side and that's Scott's side. And when Scott's sleeping, he puts, this is so funny. He lies like this. He'll lie like this, and then he'll put his arm down the split, so he lies like that. So I feel like I'm sleeping with a one-armed man. The arm disappears, but it's great because you can put the head up, and it's supposed to stop you snoring, but it doesn't you.
I put your head up, and it stops you snoring.
Put my head up in the middle of the night.
Yeah, you press the button, it goes bzzzt.
So he puts my head up in the middle of the night because I apparently snore. What? That's the dog, yes. Anybody else?
Over here.
Over there.
Hi, so I have all your CDs.
Thank you.
Yes. So I like when you're doing the Grease numbers,
yeah.
I want to know if your choice to go away from what they usually do on Broadway and with John Travolta doing the high tenor instead of the low tenor.
High tenor's not written.
Exactly, and I don't like it. And
that's John Travolta did it for the film to make it different. But the high tenor part in the original Broadway score was not there.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering, if it was more of like a personal
I did the traditional score.
That. Yeah, okay, cool.
Which is just as good as the, I love the movie.
What he did, you know,
sorry?
But it's better than what he did. It was kind of...
No, I wouldn't say it's better. I just say it's different. Yeah. But I get what you're saying. I'm trying to be diplomatic here. No, we haven't even started the house.
We started and then we stopped again.
Yeah, the front doors, we put new doors in and they're not in right. Put it this way, it's a big thing fitting in a smaller space. I think is that gentleman there? Yes.
Hi, how you doing? It's nice to meet you.
Thank you. You too.
First of all, I wanted to say that Buck Rogers was one of my favorite shows as a kid. And Kevin, I had a huge crush on your mom.
Listen, don't worry. Kevin has already heard how many men have, you know, over his mother over the years.
Kevin,
it's a great drink buyer because he'll be in bars and they'll be like, dude, your mom was so hot. So many times I got busted in my bedroom with my sock and everything. And your mother and my mom walked in on me and he's like, let me buy you a drink. Kevin's like, yep, you got to buy me a drink now for that. Thank
That's
you.
Awesome.
Yeah.